Okay, so let's get started with chapter 2. We talked about some general guidelines just on how to eat, on nutrition and what nutrition was and what influences our food choices and kind of some of the basic guidelines that we use for a healthy diet. And we're going to talk a little bit more about planning a healthy diet. We got kind of the scientific side. We got the AMDRs that 45 to 65% of the calories should be from carbohydrate, and same thing for similar for fat and protein. We got the EER, the estimated energy requirements. So we know how to calculate the calories and the grams of carbs and fats and proteins. But now you've actually got to take those calories and the grams and actually make meals with food. Okay, so that's what we're going to talk more about in this chapter. The chapter starts out talking about 6 diet planning principles. Sometimes I actually leave these out. I think they're good, but they are very vague, and so it can be kind of hard to understand these concepts, and sometimes I think just diving right in talking about the actual foods is better. But let's just quickly go over them. They are adequacy, balance, calorie control, nutrient density, moderation, and variety. Okay? So let's talk about kind of what each of these means. Adequacy. This means that you're going to eat a diet or you're going to eat foods that give you sufficient energy, so enough energy, so you have plenty of energy to do what you need to do each day, and that you eat a diet that gives you enough of all the nutrients to keep you healthy, and that's assuming you're a healthy person to begin with. Okay? So adequacy, that makes sense. Your diet is adequate in energy and nutrients. Okay? Second one, balance. You're getting enough, but not too much, of all the different food types. And this is in regards to nutrients as well as foods. Okay? You saw when we talked about the apple and the chicken example, each food provides you something different. Okay? So you don't want to eat just the same foods over and over again, or you're going to be neglecting some other nutrients that other foods may have. So in a balanced diet, foods that are rich in some nutrients don't crowd out other foods that are rich in other nutrients. Okay? So you're balancing your food intake to get all the nutrients that you need. Calorie control, calorie, same thing. Calorie control, or what did I tell you to think of when you hear energy or calorie? Energy. Okay, so we're talking about energy control. And this goes back to what we talked about last week. Energy in needs to equal energy out. What is the energy in?
Calorie intake.
Mm-hmm. Your calories that you're taking in from food. And what is your energy out? Okay, well, and I hesitated because it's not how much you're working out, it's how many calories you're using each day. Because you burn calories, you burn 1,000 to 1,500 a day just by living and breathing each day. Okay, and then what you do by walking to class, by going to the gym, by walking the dog, by cooking dinner, is your physical activity, and that burns even more on top of it. Okay? But yes, your energy out is what you burn each day. So you want those to balance. Okay? If you're not in calorie control, then what's going to happen? You're either going to gain weight or you're going to lose weight. Now, if your goal is to lose weight, then obviously that would be okay. But if you're a healthy person at a healthy weight, then you want your energy in and your energy out to balance. Okay, nutrient density. This one incorporates the concept of adequacy and calorie control. You want the most nutrients for the fewest amount of calories. So, if you get 300 milligrams of calcium from an ounce and a half of cheese, and you also get 300 milligrams of calcium from a cup of skim milk, but the cheese has twice as many calories, which one is your better choice? Which one is more nutrient dense? The milk, okay? Because you're getting the same amount of calcium, but for fewer calories, okay? If you had two oranges that were 100 calories, or you had a cup of orange juice, what would be the more nutrient-dense choice? And here, in this example, they've got the same calories. What's your more nutrient-dense choice?
Probably the oranges, because they don't contain the sugar in the oranges.
Okay, anybody else? The oranges is correct. But it's not necessarily because of the sugar in the orange juice. A lot of your oranges don't necessarily have sugar, added sugar in it. If it did have added sugar, then definitely yes. But what are you missing out on when you drink the juice instead of eating the fruit? Okay, the pulp. And what do you think that pulp is? We talked about it last week when we talked about the carbohydrates. We touched it. Fiber. You're missing out on the fiber. You also lose some of the vitamins and minerals when you actually juice it. Okay? So the more nutrient-dense choice would be the oranges. What about a cup of skim milk or a cup of whole milk? What's your more nutrient-dense choice? Your skim is your more nutrient-dense choice. Milks, or I think we touched on this last week, milks are all the same. Skim, 1%, 2% whole, except for the fat content. It gradually goes up, and whole milk has the highest amount of fat content. And that, so if the fat content's going up, the number of fat grams are going to go up, what happens to the calories? Calories go up. But whole milk and skim milk have the same calcium, the same vitamin D, the same protein. So you get just as many nutrients for fewer calories from that skim milk or that 1% milk instead of the whole milk. Okay? What about a cup of baked beans or a cup of black beans? What would be your more nutrient-dense choice?
Black.
Yes, why? Okay, your baked beans are going to have added sugar and may also have added fat. You're going to add bacon, you're going to add ketchup, you may add brown sugar, molasses, whatever your secret recipe is. So the baked beans are going to have added sugar and added fat, okay, in addition to the beans. Okay, so your more nutrient-dense choice, your lower calorie, so you're getting just as many nutrients, is going to be your black beans, okay? So that's the concept of nutrient density. And so it's essential that in order to get all the nutrients in that we need within our calorie amount and to stay in calorie balance, it's essential that we choose nutrient-dense foods most of the time. Okay? Low nutrient density foods, what do you think those are? Yeah, they don't give you many nutrients for the amount of calories. Okay? You'll sometimes hear these referred to as empty calorie foods. Did we mention this last week? Empty calorie foods. These are calories, they're calories that the food gives, and, well, they're foods that give you a lot of calories but very few nutrients. Okay. So, things like sodas, candy, potato chips, that kind of thing. High in calories typically, but you don't get really any vitamins, minerals, any of those good nutrients that you need. Okay? Okay, moderation. Moderation leads to adequacy and balance and calorie control. We're not saying you can't ever have foods again that have sugar in them, that have fat in them. But those need to be in moderation. Okay? They don't need to be everyday choices. I mean, you may have heard the kind of 80-20 rule or concept. Have I heard that before? Where you need to try to eat, I don't know actually where it came from, I don't think there's any scientific background, but if you make healthy choices 80% of the time, then usually eating less healthy choices, foods with maybe more sugar, more calories, more fat, 20% of the time, usually that'll balance out, okay? So moderation. You want to eat those less healthy foods, and specifically those foods with added sugars and solid fats, in moderation. Okay, we've talked about added sugars. We've talked a little, and those are not sugars that are naturally found in food. And we'll talk more about this in the carbohydrate chapter. The term sugar is totally misunderstood by the general public. Okay, and when we start carbohydrates, I will tell you to forget everything you think you know about sugars, okay? But there are natural sugars in food. For example, there is natural sugar in fruit. That's what makes the fruit sweet, okay? There's natural sugar in milk. That's what makes it give it a slightly sweet taste. Those sugars are not bad. The bad sugars are the ones that we add to foods, okay? They may take that sugar in fruit and combine it with another natural sugar and process it and make high fructose corn syrup. And then we add that high fructose corn syrup to carbonated water, and what do you have?
Soda.
Okay? That's where you have added sugar. Or you take table sugar and you add it to flour and some butter and you make cookies. Okay? Where you add sugar to food where it wasn't naturally there, those are the ones that we are eating way too much of, that are usually empty calorie foods, and that we need to cut back on. Now, solid fats, that's also a term in your book. Typically, and again, we'll talk more about this in the fat chapter or lipids chapter, but typically your less healthy fats are the ones that are solid at room temperature. Okay? Your healthier ones are liquid. So if you can sit a fat on this table and it does not turn liquid, it may get soft, but that's okay, but it does not turn liquid, then that's your tip off that that's usually not a healthy fat. Okay? So a stick of butter, Crisco shortening, bacon, sausage, a big steak with lots of marbling, which is the white that you see running through the meat. Okay? Those are your less healthy foods. So, and that's typically jacks up the calories and stuff as well. Okay? So those are the ones that we want to eat in moderation. Okay, and then lastly, variety. if you eat the same foods every day, okay, you're missing out on nutrients. Or maybe you get all your vegetable servings in every day, but you only eat broccoli and green beans. Okay? Well, that's not variety. Okay? You want to eat a variety of foods, and you want to eat a variety within each food group. Okay? And we're about to go through the food groups in a second, so you'll see, particularly like with the vegetable group, that there's a lot of variety in there. Any questions so far? Okay, and here is a picture. They just show on the concept of nutrient density further. Both of these breakfasts have the same calories. Look how much more food you get to eat if you choose the breakfast on the left. A bowl of cereal with bananas, with some milk, with a scrambled egg, toast, sausage, a little jelly, some looks like hot tea, and a bowl of fruit. You can have all of that for the same calories as two donuts, two chocolate covered donuts. And you're getting a lot more nutrition, right? You can see the nutrients right here that they show you. So that's a good good example of a nutrient dense choice on the left and a low nutrient density choice on the right, or empty calorie choice on the right. Okay. These are general assumptions. You will, for calorie needs, estimated energy needs, when you calculate your own, yours will likely be somewhere around there, but it may be 200 to 400 calories higher or lower. But this is basically what they start with to start planning diets and for the dietary guidelines for Americans. Let's talk about the dietary guidelines for Americans. These are key recommendations on what a person needs to eat to stay healthy. They are designed for to help people achieve and maintain a healthy weight, reduce the risk of chronic disease, and that's diseases like diabetes, heart disease, high blood pressure, and to promote overall health through diet and physical activity. They are designed for everyone age 2 and older. Okay? Emphasizes a variety of fruits and vegetables, whole grains, fat-free and low-fat milk products, lean proteins. It's low in saturated fat and trans fat, cholesterol, sodium, and added sugars. And they boiled this down to kind of four focus areas. This used to be a really long list, but they've kind of focused in on kind of four main areas. One has to do with achieving and maintaining a healthy weight. They're also reviewed and revised every 5 years based on research. Okay, so here are the focus areas. Balancing calories to manage weight. Okay, if you are overweight or obese, then trying to lose some weight. They focus on foods and food components that you need to reduce, and then ones you need to increase, and then how to build a healthy eating pattern. Okay, let me just point out a few things in the dietary guidelines. let's talk for a second about the food and food components Americans probably need to reduce. What would you say some of those are?
Sugars.
Okay, added sugars. What else? Huh? Fats, particularly saturated fats, which we're going to find out are usually the solid fats in from animal foods, and trans fats, and those are the ones that are manufactured that you find in a lot of like packaged like crackers and foods. What else? About blood pressure, what affects that?
Cholesterol.
Lower cholesterol, but that's what not what I was thinking.
Carbs.
What type of carbs?
Complex carbs.
Are
those good?
Reduce those. We eat way too many refined carbs, and again, we'll talk more about this in the carbohydrate chapter. But those are the ones that are processed that have very little vitamins and minerals and fiber. And instead, we need to eat more whole grains. Okay, so reducing our refined carbs, eating more whole grains, reducing our sodium and salt intake, saturated fat, reducing that, and cholesterol, as well as trans fat, calories from solid fats and added sugars. Things we need to increase. What do we need to increase in our diet? And it can be foods, or it can be actual nutrients. Fruits and vegetables, what'd you say?
Water.
Okay, water. Fruits, vegetables, what else?
Grilled food.
Grilled food?
Instead of fried.
Fish. Yeah, okay, well, we need to more limit fried foods. There's some controversy over grilled food that it may lead to cancer, like actually over a barbecue grills. But yes, healthier cooking methods, yeah, to reduce fat, yeah. Increase fruits and vegetables, whole grains. We particularly need to increase our dark green and red and orange vegetables and beans and peas. We need to get more whole grains. We need to increase our fat-free and low-fat dairy products that we eat. We need to get a better variety of protein. Okay? Where do we get our protein mainly? Yes. And when you say meats, you mean like beef, chicken, pork. Yes. That would be meats and poultry. Yes. We need to look outside animals. We need to stop eating so much animal protein. Okay? And get some protein from plant-based foods like beans, soy products, nuts. Choose lower fat proteins and increase potassium, fiber, calcium, and vitamin D. So make sure you'll see, I believe it's table 2-1 in your e-text. Make sure you read through those recommendations from the dietary guidelines. Okay. So then there's another component too. There's what they call the USDA food patterns. Okay, so you've got the dietary guidelines, which are recommendations for everybody age 2 and up. Then you've got the USDA food patterns. And these are going to be the food, basically the food groups. Okay, when y'all were growing up, you probably had the pyramid or the, what was it after that? Was it pyramid when y'all were growing up? Okay. So it's the pyramid. The pyramid is gone. We've got my plate now, so we'll talk about that in a second. But these are the same food groups. There are 5 major food groups. And this shouldn't be anything too new. So you've got fruits, vegetables, grains, protein foods, milk, and milk products. Sound pretty familiar? Okay, good deal. Okay, there is a recommended daily amount that you should eat each day from each group. Okay, and this is going to be based on your total calories that you need each day. Okay, so just take one of these columns. Let's say you need around 2,000 calories. Well, what that means is you need 2 cups of fruit, 2.5 cups of vegetables, 6 ounces of grains, 5.5 ounces of protein, 3 cups of milk, 6 teaspoons of oil, 258 discretionary calories. Okay, any of that seem odd? Anything missing? Y'all are a quiet group. Where are fats?
Not on there.
Correct, not on there. Okay, we'll talk. Does anybody know where fats fit?
And the milk and the oil?
The oils.
That's your oil, and I may have mentioned this last week. Your oils are typically your liquid fats, or your liquid lipids, okay? Fats, when you hear someone refer to fats, it typically means your solid ones, okay? Okay, we'll talk about where fats go in a second. But this is the general pattern, okay? If you get a plan and it's set, you know, someone says you need to eat, you know, half cups of vegetables, or you need to eat a vegetable with every meal or something. That's where this is coming from. Okay, a few things to point out. We're going to go through each food group in a second. Actually, let's go on and jump into the food groups, and then I'll come back to that slide. Okay, so why do we group the fruits together? Why do we put apples and oranges and bananas and grapes? Why do we put them all together? If we didn't know that they were fruits, why did they put all these things in the group together?
Is it all seeds?
Somewhat. But you'll notice, like avocado, I think you have it up here. Well, the overriding principle, whether we know it as a fruit or not, or meets the technical definition of a fruit, is that all of these foods are going to be really high sources or good sources of folate, vitamin A, vitamin C, potassium, and fiber. It's because they all offer those same nutrients, and they're really good sources of that. Okay? So that's why you put them in the fruit group. Okay, so over here on the left, you have some different servings. You notice if you eat dried fruit, it's about half the size of fresh fruit. And the fruits that you see listed first, these are the ones that you want to choose most of the time, like that 80% of the time. Okay? And this is going to be any fresh fruit, any 100% fruit juice, that means it has no added sugar, any canned fruit that's in water, okay, or frozen fruit that's frozen by itself, not in the syrup. Okay? Now, the second ones that you see where it says limit these, these are going to be the fruits that have added fat or added sugar. So these are the ones that we need to eat in moderation. These need to be every now and then, not everyday choices. So canned fruit and syrup, frozen fruit and syrup, juices, punches, aids, fruit drinks with added sugar, fried plantains, okay? So those are going to be your less nutrient-dense choices, okay? Okay, vegetables. Vegetables, you can see they are super rich in nutrients, several of the vitamins, potassium, fiber. You want to consume a variety of vegetables each day, and you want to choose vegetables from all five subgroups. Vegetables is a group that's divided into five subgroups, and it's done so by color, okay? You've got your dark green vegetables. Broccoli, spinach, collard greens, turnip greens, bok choy, arugula, anything super dark and leafy usually. Then you've got your red-orange vegetables. So carrots, pumpkin, sweet potatoes, red bell peppers, tomatoes, vegetable juice, some of your squashes. You've got your legumes. These are basically beans, so black beans, black-eyed peas, chickpeas, kidney beans, and then your starchy vegetables. They're going to be like potatoes, corn, green peas, lima beans. And then they've got the last subgroup is referred to as other vegetables. And it's basically vegetables that didn't really fit in any of these other groups. Okay? So things like artichokes, asparagus, bean sprouts, cauliflower, those types of things. Just as important. And so it's important that during a week you eat from all of these. Okay? These vegetables you want to consume with as little added fat and added sugar as possible. The ones with added fat and added sugar, like baked beans, candied sweet potatoes, coleslaw, French fries, potato salad, refried beans, scalloped potatoes, those type of things. They've got extra calories from the added fat or added sugar. Those are the ones that need to be not every day, every now and then. Okay? Grains. Grains are tricky. They list them in ounces. I don't know why they do that, but 1 ounce of a grain is equivalent to like one slice of bread, or half a cup of cooked rice, or half a cup of cooked pasta, 1 cup of like Cheerios. Okay? Now, when you want to make at least half or at least 50% of your grain choices whole grain. Half, if not all. Okay? Whole grains are going to be like whole wheat bread, brown rice. They list some more up there. Oats. So if you eat oatmeal, that's a whole grain. Popcorn's a whole grain. You can get whole grain crackers, pastas. You can get a wide variety these days. It used to be hard. Okay. The other ones, the refined ones, there's nothing bad. They're just less nutrient dense. Okay. Like your wheat bread that's not 100% whole wheat. Okay. Or your crackers that aren't made from whole wheat or that kind of thing. And then you definitely want to limit the grains that have solid fat or added sugars. So like biscuits, cakes, cookies, cornbread, donuts, muffins, those kind of things. Okay, jump down to protein foods. You'll notice it is not called, I think it used to be called meat, fish, poultry, maybe way back when I was in school. And now it is protein foods. There are subgroups in the protein group. You've got seafood, then you've got meat, poultry, and eggs that are grouped together, and you've got nuts, seeds, and soy products. Okay? Choose a variety of protein foods from the 3 subgroups, including seafood in place of meat or poultry twice a week. The seafood is going to be any kind of fish or shellfish, like shrimp, crab, that kind of thing. And your meat, fish, and poultry. You want to choose your leaner, lower fat cuts or trim fat off of it. And then nuts, seeds, soy products. That can be like peanut butter, almond butter. This also includes beans or legumes. So what 2 groups do you have legumes in? Vegetables and protein, yes. Okay. And then you want to limit the protein groups that have solid fats and added sugars. Usually it's the solid fats that you have to watch out with your proteins. So your really high fat meats like sausage, bacon, fried meat like fried chicken, hot dogs, cuts of meat or pork or that have a lot of fat on them. Okay. Okay, last 2, milk and milk products. You want to choose fat-free or low-fat choices. That means skim, fat-free, or 1%. You don't consume milk because there's a lot of people who may be lactose intolerant or don't like milk. Then you want to make sure you are choosing calcium-rich foods. Okay, like calcium fortified orange juice. Okay, because calcium and vitamin D are going to be your 2 big nutrients coming from this group. So they talk about fat-free and 1% milk, those type of things. Cheese, it's hard to find fat-free cheese anymore, which I kind of think is a good thing because it didn't taste too good. But and you want to limit the dairy products that have fat. So 2% milk, whole milk, cheese. Your full fat yogurts, ice creams, that kind of thing. Okay, and then oils. And they say oils are not a food group, but you've got to have them. Okay, you need some healthy fat in your diet. Okay, and oils, your liquid fats, are going to give you vitamin E and some of your essential fatty acids. You want to choose oils over solid fats. So canola oil, olive oil, vegetable oil, any of those oils over things like butter, margarine, Crisco, whenever possible, okay? Because they're going to be healthier fats. let's see. Okay. Okay, so let me go to that slide that I skipped over earlier. And we've already touched on this. Legumes are in both the vegetable and the protein group. You want to make sure you're choosing those nutrient-dense choices, those first foods without the added sugar and added fat the majority of the time. Okay? Now, I ask you where fats occurred. Fats are typically your solid fats. Okay? And another thing that we didn't factor in here was sugars. Okay? The concept behind where you saw the plan for 2,000 calories and it listed 2 cups of fruit, 2.5 cups of vegetables, all that. At the bottom, it had 238, I believe, discretionary calories. It's not something you have to memorize. Yeah, 258 discretionary calories for 2,000 calories. Discretionary calories are, it's kind of like them saying, okay, if you'll eat, you know, 2 cups of fruit, 2.5 cups of vegetables, that kind of thing, then you can have 258 calories to use on less healthy things, like added sugar, like solid fats, like alcohol. Okay? So that's why you don't see fats listed with all the food groups, because you want to choose the oils to get your fat from. Okay? Or the nuts in the protein group, or your seafood. Okay? How easy is this to follow? How many people know exactly how many discretionary calories they had yesterday? Not me. Okay? So I think it is good in theory, in concept, but it's pretty, you can't really apply that to your everyday eating. Okay? Right? Okay. So this is another way to look at it, 2,000 calories. Okay, the serving equivalents. Let me make sure I hadn't left anything out so far. In general, most people need to eat more vegetables, more fruits, more whole grains, more seafood, and more milk and milk products. Okay? Most people need to eat less sodium, saturated fat, trans fat, cholesterol, and fewer refined grains and fewer foods and drinks with added sugar and added fat. Okay? There's more information in your book about discretionary calories that you can read through. So if you put jelly on a piece of toast, would be a grain serving. Where would that jelly fall?
Empty calories.
Mm-hmm. The discretionary calories or empty calories. Okay, you'll notice when you look at the food groups that some food groups are measured in cups, some are done in ounces. But they will usually give you ways to calculate, for instance, the grains are in ounces, but it'll say, okay, 1 ounce is equal to 1/2 cup of cooked rice or cooked pasta or that kind of thing. There are guides for different ethnicities. Okay, there's a Mexican food pattern. There's an Italian food pattern, and they're geared towards those ethnicities. There's also a vegetarian food pattern. Where it gets a little tricky is with mixtures of food, like casserole. Let's take lasagna. Okay? So what? You've got your noodles. You've got your meat. And your meat sauce. You've got your cheese. So you've got probably primarily grains and protein from the noodles and the meat, right? And you've got some dairy from the cheese. Got some vegetable in there from the tomato sauce. And then you've got some discretionary calories from that fat in the cheese, unless you're using a lower fat cheese. And maybe from the fat in the meat, okay? So there also is a guide to help you kind of break down mixtures of food too, if you want to break down exactly what you're eating. Okay, but still, that's kind of hard to use. So, they created my plate. It's an educational tool, but it is designed, it combines the USDA food patterns or food groups that we just talked about with the dietary guidelines. Okay? And it is an interactive online tool, and it will create a meal plan just for you. So it's the USDA's attempt at personalizing it, making it easy for individuals to use and follow. Okay? Now, this is what took the place of my pyramid. Has anybody used my plate before in a class or otherwise? You have? Okay. This is the new icon instead of the pyramid. It's a plate that's divided into four sections. And this is the new way we need to think about food or a meal when we fix our plate. You see, half of it is fruits and vegetables. Okay? You don't have fruits and vegetables at every meal, but half your plate needs to be vegetables. Or half needs to be a combination of fruits and vegetables. Only about a quarter needs to be protein. Now, this is hard for a lot of people because a lot of people grew up where like the meat is the center of your plate. The meat is the center of your meal. Then the starch, and then maybe some little vegetables on the side. The vegetables need to be the majority. Grains, preferably whole grains, or some kind of whole grain starch, and then a little bit of protein. Okay?
Okay, you're going to use for your homework, you're going to go to my plate and actually play around on it and answer questions. It's not perfect. And even once you walk through it, you still have to kind of plan your own diet from there. The other criticism is that you have to know how to use computers. You have to have a computer and internet access. And then you have to be pretty savvy. You're not savvy, but know what you're doing on a computer. Okay? And there's a lot of the older generations that don't use a computer still. I know that seems crazy to us. But there's a lot of people who still don't. So you're missing that segment in the population. So I'm not going to go over my plate right now since you're going to do so much with that Chapter 2 worksheet. And I think you'll actually learn more by going through the questions and exploring my plate. But it goes through the different food groups. It goes through what good choices are, what a serving size is. So just play around on the site when you do your Chapter 2 worksheet. Okay, and again, I've kind of already touched on this, but what you see in this chart, the lighter color is what's recommended, and the darker color is what Americans actually eat. Okay? So you can see we're way below in our vegetables, our fruits, and our milk. We way overeat protein. Okay? We get way more protein than we need. We also get way more grains than we need. But it's not the whole healthy grains. It's the refined ones. You can see whole grains only comes up just a little bit.
Okay, exchange list. Anybody ever seen exchange list or used exchange list? Okay. These are food groups and serving sizes. They were developed to help people with diabetes plan meals. Okay? They don't use those really much anymore in meal planning for diabetics. They use a different method now. They actually count carbohydrates. But just know that they used to be used to help plan meals for diabetic individuals. Okay, so putting the plan into action. You want to familiarize yourself with each food group. Look at the different foods that you buy. Look at where you might could make improvements. One of the worst things you can do is try to overhaul your diet in one day. That's not good. Focus on little changes at a time. Okay. Processed foods. You hear about that term a lot. Processed food is any food that has been taken, like the apple and applesauce example that I gave you. Okay. Any food that has been taken from its natural state, stuff's been added to it, it's gone through the manufacturing process, you may have chemicals, you may have coloring, you may have vitamins added, but in that processing, the food loses nutrients, okay? So processed foods are rarely, if ever, healthier choices than actually eating the whole food, apple, the vegetable, the milk, whatever it is. This is an example of how they kind of took what they were supposed to eat in a day in the first column and spread it out over a day. So for breakfast, they're going to have half a cup of oatmeal and maybe a piece of toast and a cup of milk. Okay? So this is how you would take what you have to use for one day and kind of spread it out over meals and snacks. Okay, grocery shopping, they talk about refined grains and whole grains. When you pick a wheat grain, okay, it has an outer husk or shell that you can't eat. And then inside that, it's got three parts, the bran, the endosperm, and the germ. Okay? When they make all-purpose flour or white flour, they basically strip off the germ and the bran. The germ and the bran is where you have a lot of the fiber and a lot of the protein and some of the nutrients. Okay? So they strip off the bran and the germ, and so you're just left with the endosperm. And they grind it up, and they usually bleach it, and then you have all-purpose flour or self-rising flour, white flour, and you can make cookies, cakes, desserts, crackers, anything like that, okay? That is a refined grain. Whole grain is where they take the wheat grain, they take the husk off since it's inedible, but it has the bran, the germ, the endosperm, and they grind it up, okay? And you get whole wheat flour, okay? Or if this is oats that you're talking about, the oat grain, you have whole oat flour, whole rice grain, or whatever grain you're talking about. If you keep all those different parts, it's considered a whole grain. The reason that you want to eat whole grains over refined grains is they are much more nutrient dense. It has more fiber, more vitamins, more minerals, usually a little more protein. It's just a healthier choice. Okay? Any questions about whole grains or refined grains? And you can see the yellow is whole grains. The purple is something they call enriched bread. Okay, so if you made bread with refined flour, well, when you refine that wheat grain and you get the white flour, it loses a lot of nutrients. So what's typically done is they enrich that flour. They add back some of the nutrients it's lost. So it's got some of the vitamins and minerals that whole grain does, but it still doesn't have the protein and the fiber that was taken out. So enriched is similar, except for a few of them, but unenriched is not at all. You lose a lot of vitamins and minerals. Okay, food labels. How many of y'all look at food labels when you grocery shop? Some of y'all? Okay. A lot of y'all probably don't remember when they didn't have food labels. But food labels are required, except on a few foods, like if you like meat that's sold in bulk or like that's cut at the butcher counter. produce that's sold in bulk. You'll notice, like, if you bag up apples, they don't have a food label on them. Coffee, it's not required, I believe, and, like, spices, it's not required. But most everything else, it's required, and they're getting stricter in restaurants as well, with requiring restaurants that have over a certain number of locations to provide the nutrition information. This is what a food label, the standard format, looks like. It'll always have the title Nutrition Facts, followed by serving size and servings per container. To me, that's one of the most important things on there, is servings per container and serving size. Okay? And I will tell you, manufacturers try to deceive you. You pick up a bag of chips at the checkout, it looks like a single serving, you flip it over and it says 120 calories. You're like, great. Well, if you don't look at the servings per container and see that it says there are 3 servings per container, How many calories are you consuming if you eat that whole bag? 360. Yeah. Okay, you have to multiply everything by 3. So that's one of the most important ones. You have calories, total fat, and it'll be broken down to saturated fat and trans fat. Trans fat's one of the newest things to be added. Cholesterol, sodium, total carbs. And that includes dietary fiber and sugars, and then protein. And then at the bottom, you've got 2 vitamins that they have to have, vitamin A, vitamin C, and calcium and iron. Now these are expressed in percentages, and you'll see percentages over on the right side of the label too. These are based on a 2,000 calorie diet. Okay, and so they're expressed as percentages. So if you're trying to eat a 2,000 calorie diet and you eat one serving of this, then you're getting 10% of your sodium for the day. Or you're getting 25% of your iron. They give you more guidelines down here, and then you'll have your ingredients. Ingredients are listed in descending order. Okay? So whatever food or ingredient is in there the most is going to be listed first. Whatever ingredient is listed last is in there the least. Okay, so they go in descending order by weight, which is important if you're looking for something that has very little added sugar. Where do you want to see the added sugar in the ingredient list? At the end, or towards the end of the list, right? If you're wanting to buy a whole grain bread, where do you want to see whole wheat flour in the list? You better be the first ingredient, right? Okay. Trans fat and sugars on the food label are a little misleading. Trans fat, you only have to put, you can put 0 trans fat grams unless it has over 0.5 grams in the meat. So, and trans fat is one of those you really don't want any in your diet. It's so harmful. So there's a lot of foods that you could be eating that have 0.3 grams, 0.4 grams, but because they're under 0.5, it has 0 listed. Does anybody taken any of Dr. Murphy's classes and know what you look for in the ingredient list to double check that it doesn't have?
Hydrogenated.
Yes. Look for the word hydrogenated. Partially hydrogenated or hydrogenated oils. That's your tip off that it's got some trans fat. Okay, and sugars. Sugars are misleading as well because this is a combination of added sugars and natural sugars. Natural sugars are not bad, okay? It's the added ones you don't want. So you can't gain much from looking at the sugars on the label. Where do you want to look to see if it has added sugars? Look in the ingredient list. Yes, and see where it falls within the ingredient list, okay? Any questions so far? Okay. I'm gonna stop right here and we will next time we will go over your worksheet answers. So
we can walk through those. Make sure you bring them to class complete, though. And we'll also go over vegetarian diets. Okay. Also, read the chapter, because I'm not touching on every single detail in the chapter. Read the chapter and make sure you don't have questions about anything that we may not be specifically covering. Okay?